And the insurance sector could enjoy better fortunes in the upcoming year, with the uptake of products projected to be on the upswing as elections draw near. According to Jubilee Insurance Head of Medical Insurance, Catherine Karori, 2016 was a bad year for the sector, with insurance companies reporting a gross underwriting loss of 570 million shillings linked to fraudulent claims. I had a sit down with Catherine to probe her further on what is in store for the sector. Well, many thanks. We want to now discuss matters to do with medical insurance. The insurance sector has undergone significant turbulence, and we are now joined by Catherine Karori Bosire, who is the general manager in charge of medical insurance at Jubilee Insurance Company. Many thanks for making time to speak to us. Perhaps let me just start off with 2016 has been quite interesting in terms of developments around the economy. What has been the story around the insurance sector?
Well, I must say there's a couple of aspects there in terms of when you look at the health insurance industry. This is an industry that in 2006 was worth $3 billion. Today it's worth about $34 billion. So on a positive perspective, this is an industry that grows by an average of 28% every year. So it's been good growth. So when you talk about how it's been for us as an insurer, it's been good growth in terms of growing by about over 10-15% on every year basis. But rightfully, as you're saying, there's also the challenge in terms of the performance of the books. So as an industry, the regulator released the results for quarter three. The portfolio gross written premium is about $29 billion, but the underwriting loss is about $570 million. So there's a challenge there. It's a growing sector, but it's not growing profitably. So there are a couple of aspects there that we've been monitoring to see what is going on. I mean, it's an old story when you talk about fraud. Fraud in healthcare industry continues to be a menace. Why? Because there are people who do not have healthcare. There are people who want to help their relatives, so they even present the medical card to the service provider for, on behalf of their relatives. Yeah. There are people who want to make money. The health sector is also a booming business, especially on the drugs. So there are people who actually want to capitalize on it and defraud the market by taking on drugs, which they then redistribute to a black market. So there are many challenges. What are we doing about it? You have a situation whereby, as an industry, we are looking for more technology in terms of identification, mitigating identification fraud. So you have things like the biometric identification. Another thing the industry is working on, specifically ourselves, is an electronic claims platform, where we are saying, if we are able to get this claims, the service provider renders service to you, say, for example, they enter the details into a computer. They then print that information. They then deliver that information to us, where we then enter it into another computer. So when you look at the time in terms of operational efficiency, the gaps and loopholes it creates in terms of recreating and redocumenting claims that relate to services that you probably never got, that's one of the other areas we can be able to seal on the aspect of fraud. And it also creates operational efficiency. You're able to see information on a real-time basis and see what is going on. So those are some of the things that we think are going to help the industry in terms of mitigating the cost in terms of underwriting loss, operational efficiency, and being able to curb on fraud. The other thing we've seen that is quite interesting is the aspect of, it's a component of cost of treatment. When you look at the cost of the treatment, we pay about, when you look at a premium of, say, for example, almost $39 billion, a good percentage of that is outpatient. So at least $19 billion worth of premium is outpatient. When you look at the cost of treatment in terms of drugs, about 40% of every person's outpatient visit constitutes drugs. Now, within that drug conversation, what is also happening in this country, there's a lot of brands that are distributed versus generic drugs. Now, this is a market that trusts more of branded drugs, while in other markets, people are going into the conversation of generics. So if you look at markets like South Africa, they are saying, how can we make healthcare more affordable? When you look at countries like even the US, when you look at Japan, you know, there was a group actually from the, you know, the government was out, that was actually in Japan the other day. And the Japan government is saying, we need to make sure that we can be able to have, pass a law that helps people access more generic drugs and brand drugs. In South Africa, they've been able to achieve that. They have scenarios where members are told, this is the lowest cost drug that's available, whether you're stocking it or not. you're able to tell the client this is the lowest cost drug and this is what can treat your medical condition. So cost of treatment is something else that we all need to look at. You know, today when you go for an outpatient facility or a visit and you're paying an average cost of 5,000, if you have insurance, that's good. But if you don't have insurance, that's a high cost. So how can we also work with the government to be able to pass platforms and legislations that help make healthcare more affordable? So the conversation of drugs is also another component that's affecting the healthcare cost overall. And I think when you look at it, those are the issues that are really affecting the cost of treatment and therefore the causing the underwriting losses we are seeing in the country. Yeah.
And looking at this kind of sector, it has a lot of potential. Of course, we know penetration is still pretty low. It's just under 10 million Kenyans who are sort of insured. How do we grow this number to cover the entire population, at the same time ensure there's services that are affordable?
I think one of the things that people need to know, and I think the year in which we had the terrorism at the Westgate, it's amazing how much people didn't know that there are certain insurances that actually need to be taken for those risks. So health insurance will cover you for certain things, yes, but you also need to be aware of policies that we call riots and strikes or political risks and those kind of things. So there is only a certain coverage with health insurance, which we also provide. But people also need to be aware of other supporting insurances that are able to help you on the aspect of whether it's riot and strike, civil war, civil commotion, and not just for health insurance, but also for people's properties and those kind of things. So I think it's important that the public and through, and not just the public, but the Association of Health Insurers creates a campaign that will be running for people to be aware what kind of insurances do I need to best have in place in addition to my health care. How do I protect my children, my family, and how do I protect my property? So it's a good conversation to have. This is the right time to have risk mitigation. So I think that would be a good opportunity right there. Yeah.
Of course, the insurance sector has also fallen to be vulnerable in terms of fraudulent claims. How do we navigate our way around this so that we ensure there's operational efficiency and there are actually less cases of people being caught up in situations where they find they cannot afford medical care because of the fraudulent claims?
Because a lot of people say, if you say you're paying, no, first of all, when you enter a facility, they ask you, how are you paying? If it's cash, okay. If it's insurance, suddenly there's a line of tests, drugs, and all of these things. So in our sector, what we've had to do is identify partnerships of people who are like-minded. So when you look at the service providers, it's an education also to them, because it's amazing that people think that that employer has paid me as the insurer ₸1 million to be able to provide coverage of ₸1 million. And that's not the case. A lot of the times the employer has possibly paid 20, 30 or 50,000 Kenya shillings for me to give you a coverage of 1 million. It's about risk pooling. So we've had to educate the service providers and sensitize them and tell them that really, at the end of the day, this employee who has just walked in here has a limit of 100,000 or 50,000 that they are sharing for them and their family, and they need that for the next 12 months. So we've had to tell them and to teach them to be a bit more sensitive. Again, you also got to create deterrences. So you find service providers in those kind of behavior and trends, then you do something about it. You suspend them, you terminate them, you blacklist them, and you say you don't want to work with certain, because it cannot be a commercial agenda only. There's, you know, when you look at the educational sector today in terms of what is happening, in terms of improving the standards of education, we need to improve the standards of healthcare. And they cannot be done by only thinking from a commercial perspective. So we need to be able to tell the service providers, this is the standard of service we expect. Again, the other thing we do is we also have care managers. So these are people who go around visiting the patients in the hospitals, being able to check the records of what the hospital is recording on a daily basis, especially for patients who are admitted, to be able to see, was the doctor actually here? Did the doctor attend to the patient? And even ask the patient, did the doctor come? Did the doctor come to see you? Were these tests actually administered on you? And it would surprise you just what people put in. The doctor has not been there 3 days and they are billing every day. So it's also a lot of gatekeeping from our end. But, it's an ongoing battle, and we need to have people who are like-minded, who move with us in the right energy and direction to be able to make sure that we can improve health standards for you and me, and make sure then we can have more people on board. Because if it's not so expensive in terms of cost of treatment, then it gets cheaper in terms of premium, you know, what I'm charging you to buy the coverage, which then means I'm able to onboard more people who could not afford that service before. So we need to be able to reach there, actually. Yeah.
As we go into the new year, 2017, what's your outlook for the industry, and perhaps what are some of the low-hanging fruits that the government can quickly translate and ensure we have a vibrant health sector?
I think the government, you know, and you know the CS now was actually in private sector leading a key hospital. There's many pockets in terms of creating automation. So that looks like a long way off when you think about government, but who would have dreamed of e-registration for your driving license and for your tax? So what we're saying is that that's possible, and from a government perspective, that's very doable. We need to be able to find a lot of automation because there's a lot of wastage in manual processes, even for them to be able to manage, to be able to track, you know, the medication, the dispensing of drugs, the treatments. And then how else do you also monitor health outcomes? How do you monitor that this person was here a year ago if you're holding on to a file? And you see that a lot, you know, people holding on to a file, doctors holding on to files. But how are you able to have better track to be able to see the history? How does a hospital actually look up data in terms of what are they treating in this community, in this environment? So that's my appeal to government. You know, let's automate, let's create efficiencies, let's have better tracking devices and the platforms to be able to see this is what we are treating the Kenyan population for. Let's have the conversation of medication as well. Why is it so expensive today? How can we make it more reasonable? How do we educate the population to say a brand or a generic? A generic is equally of good, you know, efficacy. So I think those are the low-hanging fruits. The CS has been in the private healthcare sector, so he knows it both ways, and I think those are some of the things that need to be put in place. What is the perspective for 2017?
Well, the growth areas.
Yes, I think micro is a good growth area because today, when you look at people and having harambees all the time when somebody is not well, I think the public now knows that there are healthcare financing options. So people know they can come together and be able to raise a little money and pay a little money to be able to have some form of healthcare. A couple of years ago, we launched a product as Jubilee Insurance where we were saying that for your trip with a bus company, between point A to B, we will cover you should you have any accidental injuries when you go to a hospital. So the options are there. The low tickets are there. So I see that as a growth area because I think people are now appreciating, hey, I may need some money if I'm going to get treatment. I see the other opportunities is really the small and medium-sized sector because employment is, you know, I think this year was a bit restrained in terms of we saw a lot of organizations actually restructure and retrench. So there's going to be a lot of mushrooming businesses. There's going to be a lot of innovation in terms of people to just have their own businesses. And those are also opportunities where we can grow. The retail sector is also another sector. Individuals, people who are saying, hey, I have a child, I have a small family, I don't need to be thrown into debt by one bill. It could be anything, it could be pneumonia even. Yeah. So that doesn't need to happen. So I think those, as long as we are creating the conversation that's still going on about the importance of healthcare, I think there'll be good uptake. And of course, you know, I mean, the governments are expanding, they're also our buyers from us. When you look at the counties, they're buying healthcare insurance from actually private sector. So I think those should continue to be good growth sectors. And those are the opportunities, not necessarily. And also, again, when you look at large multinationals coming into the market, creates employment, creates health insurance platforms. So it's a good outlook. Yes.
Thank you very much, Catherine Karori Bosire, for speaking to us. And that brings us to the end of that conversation.